Well, good day, everyone. My name is Jon Robertson, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this mock mediation sponsored by the Scottish Land Commission and the Agricultural Law Association in this Scottish Mediation's Year of Mediation. Circumstances could hardly have changed more in the period since we first started preparation for this mock mediation. Moving to an online webinar, however, is simply reflective of what has happened with mediation over the past 8 months. Whilst other more traditional forms of dispute resolution have had their difficulties over that same period, mediation has actually gone from strength to strength, and the mediators who will be working with us in this mock mediation have reported how effective mediation can be when undertaken online. You'll hopefully all benefit not only from seeing mediation in operation in an agricultural law context, but also from seeing mediation working effectively online. You will all have received a briefing note setting out the background to the current dispute at Pitlochie Farm, a fictional farm that was first created for the Agricultural Law Association's mock mediation in 2009. I will shortly give an introduction to mediation in an agricultural law context, and will be followed by the Tenant Farming Commissioner, Bob McIntosh, who will summarise the lessons learned from the Scottish Land Commission's pilot mediation scheme. Bob will be followed by Robin Burley of the Mediators Skill, who will give an introduction to mediation and to the skills mediators use in mediating. You can then view the introductory session to the mediation at your leisure, and the mediation proper will follow in two separate webinars. You will only see an edited summary of the actual mediation. All the actors in the process and our mediators have undertaken many hours of work to produce the edited version that you will see. And each of them has to be applauded for the huge amount of work that they've put into this process and the very considerable effort they have put into making the mock mediation you will see as realistic and informative as possible. I'm sure you will all agree that they've done an absolutely marvelous job. So moving on to mediation in an agricultural law context, this is thankfully relatively straightforward, but unfortunately in a somewhat roundabout way. The agriculture holdings legislation provides that most disputes that arise between the parties to an agricultural lease are to be determined by the Land Court. Section 61 of the 1991 Act and Section 78 of the 2003 Act, however, provide that subject to some exceptions, the parties to a 1991 Act tenancy, an SLDT, an LDT, an MLDT, a repairing tenancy, or a grazing or mowing lease may, at or after the time when the matter arises, instead of having the matter determined by the Land Court, have the matter determined by arbitration. Arbitration for this purpose includes any other method of resolving the matter, and arbiter is to be construed accordingly. So once the matter has arisen, other than in respect of the matters that are reserved exclusively to the Land Court, the parties are able to agree to use any method of dispute resolution to determine any matter that arises between them. As the parties can only agree to have the matter determined other than by the Land Court at or after the time when the matter arises, any attempt to restrict the right of the landlord or the tenant to have a matter determined by the Land Court in the lease itself or in any other document entered into before the matter arises is null and void. The parties in dispute can only agree to arbitrate in the widest sense of that word when the matter in dispute has arisen. So how does mediation fit into this? It might be thought that where there is a dispute between the parties in an agricultural lease, then mediation is a method of resolving the matter. But I think not. The parties can agree to the matter being determined by arbitration, which of course means determined by an arbiter instead of the matter being determined by the Land Court. And the word determined is important here. Lord Gill refers to determined in this context as meaning brought to a decisive and binding conclusion. I think also that in this context, it must mean that the method of resolving the matter has to be a method where the matter is resolved by someone other than the parties themselves, someone who issues a determination like an arbiter who imposes a decision. Mediation is, of course, a means by which the parties are assisted to reach an agreement rather than a means by which a binding decision is imposed. Mediation involves neither a third party imposing a decision nor a decision being imposed by the outcome of the process. So why is this distinction important? I think the answer lies in Section 61A2 of the 1991 Act, with a corresponding provision in the 2003 Act. If the parties agreed to arbitration instead of going to the Land Court, they are deprived of the right to litigate in the Land Court. There is no corresponding provision stating that the same applies to any other method of resolving the matter, but I think the implication has to be that it does. As we have seen, the ability to go to arbitration, in the widest sense of that word, is instead of going to the Land Court. An agreement to mediate, however, is no different from the parties agreeing to negotiate to resolve the dispute, and it cannot have been Parliament's intention that if the parties agree to negotiation and the negotiations fail, that the parties are precluded from going to the Land Court. By embarking on a process of mediation, the parties are not committing to a process in which a binding decision will be imposed on them, and they are therefore not taking advantage of the rights afforded by Section 61. As I say, a roundabout way of getting there that is not helped by rather poor draftsmanship. In short, mediation falls entirely out with the ambit of the agricultural holdings legislation. The parties can mediate, and their rights to litigate in the Land Court will not be affected if the mediation does not result in a settlement agreement. Thank you to Sir Crispin Agnew for pointing me in the right direction on this, and to Lord Minganish, the chairman of the Scottish Land Court, for confirming this view. Where a mediation does reach a conclusion and the parties sign a settlement agreement, the position changes. At that point, a new contract is created, the settlement agreement. And if the parties wish to dispute the subject matter of that agreement, it would be necessary for them to litigate on that contract. We cannot have a presentation by a lawyer without a case being referred to. And here it is, one of several Kildrummy Jersey Limited cases, which contains some support for this. The court, when considering whether an agreement contracting out of the 1991 Act's provisions was effective, held that the agreement, being an attempt to effect a comprehensive settlement of all the rights of the defender as an outgoing tenant, including the Land Court proceedings, and entered into after the notice to quit and counter notice, was not in breach of Section 21(1) of the 1991 Act. In other words, the agreement was enforceable in the Court of Session and not in the Land Court. A mediation settlement agreement would therefore be in the same position. The parties have not contracted out of their right to go to the Land Court by agreeing to mediate, but by resolving their differences through mediation and entering into the settlement agreement, they have moved to a position where that agreement can only be enforced and disputed in the ordinary courts and not in the Land Court. So mediate away. That therefore is mediation in an agricultural law context. Thankfully, it is for others to explain the mechanics and benefits of mediation, and I look forward to hearing more on that and to finding out if the Pitlochie Farm parties will find success through their mediation. And I hope you will all find the mock mediation to be both interesting and beneficial. It's now my pleasure to hand over to Bob McIntosh, the Tenant Farming Commissioner. Thank you very much.
When the role of the Tenant Farming Commissioner was created, the main objective was to foster good relations between landlords and tenants of agricultural holdings. And the TFC was given powers to issue codes of practice and to investigate alleged breaches of the codes. But I've always taken the view that the codes should be there to help people reach agreement rather than as a means of catching them out. So therefore, I will do all I can to prevent things reaching a state where one party feels that they have to make a formal complaint about the behaviour of the other, because that's not a good way to build good landlord-tenant relationships. So with that in mind, I've always seen my role as something of a mediator, and I like to think that Sarah and I have had some success in helping to resolve issues without them becoming the source of litigation or indeed a formal complaint about a breach of the code. However, we're not professional mediators, and there have been cases where we were not able to bring the parties together, but where we still felt that litigation was avoidable. So we therefore introduced on a trial basis a scheme that provided free professional mediation in cases where we felt that this was justified. The Land Commission met the costs of the mediators, and the landlord and tenant met their own costs of professional support. We offered this service in the case of three long-standing and difficult to resolve cases, and with varying degrees of enthusiasm, it has to be said, all the parties involved agreed to participate. Mediation resulted in all three cases reaching a satisfactory outcome and in very positive feedback from participants about the process. Notably, both landlords and tenants said that mediation had enabled them to address issues that they felt couldn't have been resolved in court. They felt very happy with the outcome as they'd been directly involved in reaching a decision themselves. And very importantly, I think, they felt that the process had given them a basis on which to rebuild the landlord-tenant relationship moving forward. So following the success of the pilot mediation service, the Land Commission's ultimate aim is to mainstream the use of mediation in the tenant farming sector so that the support of the TFC and the Land Commission is not required. And although considerable progress has been made in the last 2 years, the culture of alternative dispute resolution is not yet firmly established in the sector, and there are no established mechanisms in place to promote and provide easy access to mediation services. The Land Commission also recognises that supporting a culture of dispute resolution in the tenant farming sector is likely to provide lessons in relation to wider land reform problems. So at this point in time, we have concluded that TFC support is still valuable, particularly in providing reassurance about the mediation process to potential participants and in providing the oversight that encourages participants to engage productively. So we will therefore be introducing next year a revised support scheme, which will provide, at our discretion, financial support towards the cost of mediators appointed by the parties from a TFC-approved panel of mediators. And details of this scheme will be published very shortly. So I'm fully convinced that mediation has a potentially important part to play in resolving landlord-tenant issues that might otherwise simply fester or which might result in litigation of one form or another. And I very much hope that this event today will help to improve the understanding of how mediation can be used within the sector.
My intention in this presentation and our mock mediation, which we will run in 6 video clips throughout the webinar, is to shed light on the process of mediation and the techniques of mediators. Of course, we would like more disputes to come to mediation by spreading a greater understanding of its potential. But there is another reason to show you the workings of mediation. As mediators, we firmly believe that the more understanding people who engage in mediation have, as principals or as advisors, the more effective their participation is, and the better and more creative the outcomes. More than that, if people use mediating ways, which we can all do, we will lessen the damaging impact of disputes and benefit from the creativity that can come from difference and, yes, even conflict. So what is mediation? Some people say that that mediation is an easy option and only for tree huggers, while others think it is one of the black arts with outcomes that are reached mysteriously or even magically. It may well lack some of the cut and thrust of our adversarial system of justice, but that is because there's less drama and more deconstructing. I think you will find anyone who's taken part in mediation, even experienced negotiators, will come out of it saying it was an exhausting experience. What is demanding in mediation is that the process really requires participants to thoroughly explore their situation and be open, not just to scrutiny, but a deep understanding of needs and interests, probably deeper than they have ever experienced before. Parties are encouraged to think outside the box and generate options for resolution that go well beyond the remit of a judge or arbitrator and produce innovative and stimulating new ways of thinking and working. If you've taken part in a negotiation between two or more people that disagree, led by a trained, impartial mediator, tree hugging will be far from your mind. You may well describe the experience as a tough call, personally challenging, and physically and mentally exhausting. But this is usually followed by, "It worked, it saved money, and I can now move on from the dispute with fresh energy." Another way we may look at what is mediation is from the angle of where it comes in the dispute resolution spectrum. If we think about a continuum with disputes resolved by use of law or our rights at one end, and disputes settled by what matters most to us or our interests at the other end, we can distribute the ways of resolving disputes at different points along the continuum. The most straightforward way is simply to communicate with the person we disagree with. While at the other extreme, we might put the creation of legislation. Moving along the continuum from legislating, we might litigate through our courts and our tribunals. Or at the other end, we may escalate communication into a more formal negotiation. Another way of applying laws and contracts could be by arbitration. And then, next to negotiate in my continuum, we have mediate. If I group the three on the right and the three on the left, we can see that the right-hand side is about decisions on disputes based on a third party's determination of the rights of disputants, while the group on the left are all interest-based methods of settling disputes. Another way to see the two groups is that the group on the right are methods of judicial and extrajudicial determination. On the left, it is all about methods of self-determination. Bearing in mind these distinctions, which in my view are fundamental, the expression ADR, or alternative dispute resolution, which lumps arbitration and mediation together, confuses the characteristics of two very different dispute resolution processes. Another characteristic of mediation which makes it distinctive from arbitration is that the parties take part in mediation voluntarily. Agreement to mediate, like the model agreement you have in your pack, which parties enter into before participating in mediation, confirms the voluntary basis of mediation, and that the parties are free to withdraw at any time. As explained in the previous slide, mediators don't act in an adjudicative or judicial way like an arbiter or judge. The mediator's role is facilitative, but not neutrally so, as one might expect of a judge who does not help either side in a dispute. Impartiality is a state of not being biased towards one or other party, and being even-handed is fundamental to the role of a mediator. However, the mediator is very actively engaged in encouraging both parties towards a forward-looking, resolution-focused, self-determined outcome. As one of the mediator's comments in the pre-mediation meeting, while the role is impartial, it is one of actively helping both parties to find ways forward, which feels multipartial. The third principle on which mediation depends is confidentiality. It is without prejudice negotiation, which, if it does not end in resolution between the parties, leaves them free to pursue any legal remedies they may have had open to them prior to mediation taking place. While not strictly a principle, flexibility is certainly a characteristic of the mediation process, which distinguishes it from other resolution processes. It describes a few key benefits of mediation. It is unlike most other processes, which are solely focused on rights and wrongs of past actions and behaviours. Mediation does not shy, though, from the experience of the past, but it is pragmatic, future-focused, and it searches for resolution. Similarly, it's not bound by legal remedies, but can search for creative solutions. Mediation is not only a highly successful process, with resolution being achieved in something like 4 out of 5 cases that are mediated, but once parties have reached an agreement, compliance is even higher. Probably because the process of parties determining their own outcomes translates into commitment to follow through what was agreed. This process of people being engaged personally can often lead to preservation and even renewal of relationships. Abraham Lincoln, who was president in the US after the most divisive time in Republican and Democratic disputes, the American Civil War, he said, "I don't like that man. I must get to know him better." By creating a context for dialogue, mediation truly is an occasion when parties get to know each other better. My fifth point is the value people place on procedural justice. What this recognizes is that our perception of justice is not just about right and wrong, but it is also important how we feel we have been treated by the justice system. That is why people who go through a judicial or adjudicative process often come out of the other end, whether they have won or lost, feeling diminished and sometimes cheated by the system. Research confirms that justice is not only the outcome of deciding right and wrong, but also providing parties with an opportunity to be heard in a forum where they are being listened to carefully. It is this aspect of giving voice to the parties and them feeling they are being treated fairly in the process that is so important. If those are the benefits of mediation, what have the parties that have taken part said they appreciate about this process? In a study by Aberdeen University, the following are the things that were most often quoted by parties in sheriff court mediations. Parties appreciated being asked questions, but it's not just the interest shown by being asked that they appreciated. They felt listened to and assisted in expressing themselves about the dispute. Parties also appreciated that they were helped to think through their interest and needs and the strengths and weaknesses of their position. And parties not only welcomed the meetings the mediator held with them in private, but also the joint meetings which provide direct engagement between the parties in a managed setting. Finally, the process and the mediator role helped the parties to see different approaches to the dispute and possible ways of resolving it. A mediation is often thought of as an event on the mediation day, but in the lead up to the event, there are things to do and people to see, as the saying goes. The initiation of a mediation may come about because an organisation with a sector of interest or authority suggests it, and sometimes that body will act as a sponsor by offering the service to the disputants. In other situations, a professional advisor or a friend or a colleague might suggest it. Once the parties have made the decision to go to mediation, comes the selection of a mediator. There is usually a healthy debate about which is most important, mediator skills or sector skills. But there is general agreement that the mediator should have no conflict of interest with either party. Once a mediator has been appointed, they will usually take the initiative to find out about the party's requirements and concerns to make the necessary arrangements. Mediations can be set up and carried through in just a matter of weeks, and in some circumstances, a few days. And during this time, the mediator may well be meeting with the parties and their advisors to provide information, build trust, and offer reassurance, which can help to retain commitment to the process. Prior to the mediation, we need to ensure that on the day, the groundwork which may be needed has been done. This usually involves the preparation and exchange of information which will be needed in the course of negotiations. It is also important to establish that everyone who needs to be part of the decision-making process is known. In advance of the mediation session, there is usually a need for a meeting involving the mediator with the parties and/or their advisors. A typical meeting is now going to be part of this video. Preparing for mediation requires mediators, the parties and their advisors to engage in this planning and groundwork. It may be carried out by correspondence, telephone, and online meetings. And it may involve the mediators meeting with the parties and their advisors individually or collectively. For illustration purposes, we have covered this stage in a single planning meeting. The topics that need to be covered to prepare for mediation includes participants, who attends, parties and advisors, the need to consult anyone else, and reassurance that the parties have the authority to reach agreement. The venue, whether it is physical rooms or online, scheduling meetings, and finding out if there is a need to provide Zoom practice for participants. The practicalities, such as a location, or if online, arranging sessions to avoid long Zoom meetings, which can be tiring. Summaries and documents. What is available that describes and defines the dispute, and what needs to be produced, for example, a summary of or issues paper, an inventory and valuations, and a plan and photographs. Mediation processes and principles are explained by the mediators so parties will know what to expect at the mediation. And finally, the mediators require all participants to agree to and sign the agreement to mediate. These topics can be dealt with in different ways, but to illustrate the preparation activities, we have brought these parties together with the mediators in the online pre-mediation meeting which follows. Welcome to Pitlochie Farm Mock Mediation. I would like to introduce the Pitlochie players, all of whom have had their credit cards checked by the webinar organisers and have entered into contracts with disclaimers that nothing they say in the course of the videos can be taken to represent their personal views or the organisations they hail from. In this mediation, we have a tenant side, a landlord side, and the mediators. The landlord, Sean Bellway, is played by David Johnson, and the tenant farmer, George Smith, is played by Christopher Nicholson. The other actors, Heather Bruce, Hamish Lean, Mark Fogden, and Tom Oates, are themselves. Pamela Lyle and Lindsay Burley are mediators in real life, and they will be co-mediating, which is a little like working as co-chairs of a meeting. The farmer George Smith took over Pitlochie from his father, and he hopes his daughter Megan will become the farmer on his retirement. However, the landlord, Sean Bellway, issued a notice to end the partnership next year, which will effectively bring George Smith's hopes of three generations farming Pitlochie to what he sees as a premature end. Ending an agreement of this nature is rarely straightforward, and Sean Bellway and George Smith have agreed to see if they can resolve their differences by mediation. We will now join the pre-mediation meeting just after the introductions and at the point when one of the mediators is welcoming everyone to the meeting.
It's lovely to see you all, and thank you very much for coming along to this pre-mediation meeting. Now, I know you've all had a chance to meet each other, so I'm simply saying welcome, and I'm going to introduce Pamela Lyle and myself, Lindsay Burley. We're your mediators for the mediation on 7th and 8th December. This is an opportunity to run through some practicalities and say a little bit about the mediation.
Thank you, Lindsay. Please feel free just to chip in at any time. If there's any questions you've got, feel free just to ask them, because we want you to feel as comfortable as you can about the process. And this is your opportunity to ask anything that you have, burning issues that you have. Can I just say, first of all, that it is going to be a confidential discussion. And that means that it's confidential when you're with in your own teams, but it's also confidential when you come together. So Lindsay and I are not going to take anything from what you say and pass it on to the other room until you advise us that you want to do that. Now, we will be asking you very clearly, we will be asking you if you do want us to pass it on, because that's quite important that we actually get that flow of information. But you are in control, absolutely, you're in control. I'm looking at George and I'm looking at Sean as I say this. You're in control of the tap of information. So don't feel under any pressure to say yes to us if we say, can we take that to the other room? You must feel comfortable with doing that. So I'm going to talk quite a lot about confidentiality during the course of the mediation, and I make no bones about that. I will be saying quite a lot about it, because it is really, really important that everybody gets that. Can I also just talk about the information exchange, summaries and documents? I've seen a briefing paper. Is there anything else? Is there anything that the I'm looking at Heather and at Hamish, that the solicitors have prepared that maybe is helpful in this regard?
If I can come in here, Hamish, at this stage, Pamela, we have now prepared a draft schedule of tenants' improvements for the purposes of the tenants' amnesty. Great. And I'll arrange to share that with Heather prior to the mediation taking place.
That's excellent. Heather, will you want to say something?
We've prepared a summary of the main key background issues, some of which I'd hope I might be able to agree with Hamish, and some of which would identify the issues which remain in dispute and points which parties are hoping to sort out, which I would hope to exchange with Hamish in advance of the 7th and 8th of December.
That sounds good. I think the more that can be agreed in advance, the better, you know, the better the prospects of actually resolving the outstanding issues are. So I would encourage you, Heather, to do that, to send that to Hamish. Is that okay, Hamish, with you?
Yep. Yes, of course it is.
That's grand. Good. Okay. What about the land agents? And I'm now looking at Mark and at Tom. Is there anything you're going to prepare? Because what we've got is very general, and a very general outline, I think. Is there anything, can you break down the figures? Tom, come in.
I think at this moment in time, what we've looked at is just the basic schedule to start with.
Okay. Mark?
Likewise.
That's grand. Okay. Can I also say that if there are any, if you've got any proposals for how you want this to be resolved, and you don't, you know, you can put them down on paper, you can send them, you can exchange them with each other, but you can also send them to both Lindsay and I as private and confidential. As long as they're marked very clearly as for ours only, we will treat that as strictly confidential. So if there's anything that you're thinking about, that you're concerned about, that you think this might be the thing that unlocks it, but I don't really want to mention it in the presence of the other party, please do just say that to us. Is that fair enough, Lindsay? Have I covered everything there?
Were you going to just say a word about our role?
Yeah, I was going to say something about that. Our role as the mediators is very clear that we are not actually making any decisions. We're not a judge. We're not saying who's right and who's wrong. We are facilitating the coming together of the different parties in this scenario. And I think that's really helpful that you understand that. I mean, sometimes people say we are impartial. I really don't like that. I don't like that phrase, I'm impartial, because I think I'm multipartial. I think I'm partial for everybody. I want there to be a resolution. I want people to come together. I want it to work. I'm not just standing back. I'm not disinterested. I'm not neutral. So I think that's, but I'm not going to make a decision, and neither is Lindsay. Is that fair enough, Lindsay?
Absolutely. And I think the other thing is we have checked that we, neither Pamela nor I, have any conflict.
That's right.
With any of you. Thank you very much, Pamela. I'm going to go on, I suppose, to the more to the practical side of things, the who and where and when stuff of the mediation. And first of all, just about the who. Now, you have had sent to you already, I know, a draft agreement to mediate with the boxes filled in as we understand the attendees are going to be. So this is the opportunity to check that we've got that right. Sean, I understand that your father has been very involved in the partnership previously. Is he somebody that you would be contacting or in any way during the day?
Yes, quite likely we would be contacting him just to get his opinion and his feedback, because he's been very influential and taken a great interest in what's going on, although he's not terribly well at the moment. But just to be clear within that, I have the authority to sign on behalf of the company if we need to at the end of it, but certainly we would be liaising with him.
That's very helpful. Sean, in that case, I think we'll probably get him added to the agreement just to sign off. Just as we have at the moment, we have Megan, George's daughter, on the agreement, although I think I'm right, George, in saying, I mean, she's obviously an interested party that you would be wanting to probably have some discussion with during the day. It signs her up to the confidentiality agreement. Similarly, that's what we'd be doing with Sean's father. Is that right, George?
Yes, so she's my daughter. She's has an interest in the outcome of this, and I would like to consult with her, and she's on the agreement and understands the confidential nature of the agreement.
Yeah. Heather wants to say something. Let's come in with Heather.
Sorry to add another question, but yes. My client's wife, Sue, has been having a number of discussions with me relating to some of these matters. So if that applies to Mr. Belway Sr., I wonder if Sue should be a signatory as well, just in case Sean wants to have any discussion with her during the course of the mediation.
I think so. I mean, my own view, I mean, possibly mediators have different views of this, but I think anybody that you can identify without it becoming a cast of thousands who's going to be important to consult and therefore share confidential information that's gone on, or confidentiality of the mediation, should actually be caught on the agreement to mediate and just signed up to it, even if they're not consulted. Okay, the next thing, and sticking with the agreement to mediate, is just to ask whether you've any questions about the substance of it or about the terms of it. Are there any queries that you have on that? No, I'll take silence to be assent. Thank you very much indeed. Well, the only other thing about the agreement is once we've added in the names and designations, and we'll get those
sorted out outside the meeting, then I will send a final agreement to mediate to you, and I'll ask you to sign in counterpart. Okay, I'm going to move on from the agreement to mediate just to a little bit about the day itself. We've gone through with you the familiarization of Zoom, so you're familiar with the breakout rooms that we can use. And that comes back really to Pamela's point about private meetings, the importance of confidentiality in the private meetings, the opportunity to have the private meetings, and also, obviously, the opportunity to have a joint meeting as we're having just now. So on the day itself, you'll come in via Zoom, we'll put you into your own rooms as parties and have a brief discussion with you, Pamela and myself, with you each, and then we'll bring you together. And I think, Pamela, you did check that everybody's going to be happy to be together at the beginning of the mediation. And that's how we'll really...
Yeah, they seem to say that they were, yeah.
Yeah. So once you're all together, what we'll start off with, and it's really the, I wouldn't say it's a formal part of the meeting, but there's a little bit of formality in it, in that each party makes an opening statement. What are the issues? What are the key points? Very brief, 5 to 10 minutes, only that sort of length of time. And what is it that you're wanting to achieve from the mediation itself? Now, you need to, as groups, the groups and the parties decide who's going to lead on that.
Can I just come in here and say that it doesn't need to be just one of you that speaks.
No.
There can be a few of you speak if that is appropriate. Sometimes it's helpful for the party to speak and talk about how it's affected them, this dispute. And then the lawyer might come in and talk about the legal framework against which you're operating. So don't feel that you're restricted to only one person speaking. You can have two or three. You can have the land agents as well speaking. That might be quite interesting to get their take on it.
And by the way, when I say 5 to 10 minutes, we won't have a stopwatch going or anything like that. It's just to give you an idea of what we're looking for at the beginning. And that's really uninterrupted time as well, that opening statement, so that we're all really listening to whoever's speaking is actually saying. There'll be plenty of opportunity after that to get into conversation, to get into discussion. And the other thing to say is that we will set up more than just the breakout rooms for the parties. We'll set up, whether they're used or not, breakout rooms for the solicitors and breakout rooms for the land agents, because what we find is that as we get into things, Heather and Hamish may well want to have a discussion, Mark and Tom may well want to have a discussion, George and Sean may well want to have a discussion. We can just handle that as it comes. Once we move past the openings and the putting the issues on the table, if you like, we'll be unpacking the past and the future issues, but we will be very future focused. Our job, as Pamela's already said, is to facilitate this, but we'll hopefully be helping you to think about the future and what your interests are. And helping you to develop options for moving things forward before we get into negotiations. But this is not a script. We may go backwards and forwards between different parts of this before we can get, I hope, to the final outcome, which is a settlement between you so that you can actually have an agreement at the end of the mediation. Let me pause there and just see whether there's any questions that you have for either myself or for Pamela at this point.
What is the validity of the mediation in terms of we sign a mediation agreement at the end? What is the enforceability of that? It's enforceable under contract.
Pamela, do you want to just say a little word about this?
Yeah, I'm happy to. A settlement agreement is an agreement between the parties. I would encourage you, and I'm looking at Heather and Hamish, to think about how you want to resolve this. And if you can have on the books, as it were, on the stocks, on your computers, a boilerplate template for a settlement agreement, then that would be helpful. That can then be populated with the parties and the figures and all that kind of stuff. That would be useful. The settlement agreement is something that it's binding when it's reduced to writing. It is binding. So please do think about that in terms of how you actually construct it. That would be helpful. And I'm not intending to say anything more than that, because you both got very good legal advisors present in the presence of Hamish and the person of Hamish and Heather. So I won't say anything more about it, but I do think that's really quite critical that you get good advice. Does everybody feel quite comfortable about what's been suggested so far? Yeah? That's grand. Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you for that. Yeah. Well, I think is that probably us, Lindsay?
Yep. I think it probably is. So we'll obviously there's just a little bit of paperwork, a little bit of exchange of documents and so on to happen. But otherwise, we look forward to seeing you on the 7th of December.